So let's finish, wrap up the spatial filtering topic and start with edge detection. Okay, I think we've already covered. This is again comparing this time to order statistics filter, averaging or smoothing filter like Gaussian or adaptive noise filter. This was another one which tries to this time enhance the contrast. So actually contrast enhancement filtering, depending on the purpose, of course, filtering may be just trying to reduce noise or denoise, or it may be the goal may be just to enhance rather than denoise, as in this example. For instance, here, this is like the previous one, you see, subtracting the local mean from the current intensity. I mean, RC is row and column, the pixel coordinate. Now this time it is weighting this or scaling this difference with a coefficient inverse of the coefficient of variation. Okay, so when again there is a lot of variation in the neighborhood, it may want to scale in some way by K1, for instance, and you add back the local mean on top with another weight here. Of course, K1, K2 should vary between 0 and 1. So the goal here for this filter is you can analyze this. Areas of low contrast, which is, we'd say, we assume I can detect areas of low contrast in the image by a low standard variation. And I'm trying to boost those, okay? Because if it's low standard variation here, this, yes, exactly. The weight of this first term is large, so this difference is exaggerated. You see the mean is added back, okay? To restore, yes, added back to restore local average brightness. Yes, here is a practical suggestion or tip. It is often helpful to shrink the histogram of the image before applying this filter. This is trying to say, because when we do these scalings by K1 and K2, we may be really boosting the intensity too much, and there may be overflow, underflow in both sides, 0 to 255 range. So then we would see really artifacts in the image if we don't deal with those. One idea would be, of course, just to clip those, but then we may not be able to see the boosting effect here or enhancement effect. So yeah, another idea is shrink the histogram, meaning just carry the or squeeze the histogram or intensity range to maybe a smaller range an intensity window in the middle of the whole intensity range, okay? Yes, this is clipping. You have to be careful, and you have to do this clipping to your filtered image. Check the range of the resulting or filtered or enhanced image intensity. We've seen also this color image filter. You can apply the filter to RGB separately or just the intensity component. It could be in another color space like hue, saturation, intensity. We did not cover it, different color spaces, but you can easily take an RGB image and use the color transform, available color transforms to move to a hue, saturation value or intensity color space and do your calculations there and come back, okay? So this was a nice example, I think from an old paper. Another, I think we've also seen this, trying to actually bring out the details, the desired details in these rock formations. I think this is where we left last time. This is another enhancement operator. It's sharpening, meaning trying to make the edges sharper. It tries to enhance edges, and edge is actually today's topic, but let's start a little bit upfront. Edges will really correspond to high frequency components typically, but remember, in this course we are not studying we are not doing our analysis in the frequency domain. I mean, we of course know edges should be in the high frequencies. We will come to that later, but we will still work with spatial operators. So here the goal will be to create a edge-like image and subtract that from the image to get an enhancement. So let's see. This is the idea actually, very simple. Let's say 1D signal, of course, we do this for images, but it could be any dimensions. So illustration is easy for a 1D. So this is the idea of unsharp masking. So A is original signal, B is the blurred version. Now you guys know how to do the obtain this blurred version from here. What would you do to get the blurred signal from the original signal? Exactly, average filter, for instance. Yeah, smoothing, smoothing filter, the ones we've learned last time. Then take the difference, subtract this blurred signal from the original signal. You see, I have actually here, you see in the dashed lines, the original signal overlaid over the blurred signal. This will really actually emphasize the edges, right? The smoothed out regions in the image. So this creates an unsharp mask. Now add this unsharp mask, which really actually is nothing but these signals where the difference between sharp corners or edges in the image from the blurred signal are high, right? So then add this unsharp mask onto the original image and get a sharpened signal. Of course, this is a little bit artificial enlargement enhancement, but still we are exaggerating, emphasizing or boosting the these contrast transition regions, okay? This is called unsharpened or sharpened signal. Sorry, this is unsharpened mask, this is sharpened signal. So this is an example for an image this time, 2D signal. The previous one was a 1D signal. So we, for instance, first take this image, smooth it using a mean filter, 3x3. Now you guys know how to write this and do that. Then subtract that filtered image from the original image, okay? Exactly, F is, let's say, the original image. Subtract this F smooth. Now you have this unsharp mask GXY. Let's say it's this one here. Okay, so here, let's say it's we subtract all frequency components from the image. In a way, we are high pass filtering the image, right? We are left with only high frequency edge descriptions. Now add that. Remember, this was unsharp mask. This was the original image. Add the unsharp mask onto the original image. Obtain this image on the right. You see, now I have just compare this guy to this guy. There are some background changes, actually. You are manipulating the image, of course. You see the background color. I see it a little bit darker than this one. But the goal here, or just observation we have to make here, is the edges compared to the original image are sharper. Can you see that? There, when adding this on top of the original, there is a weight typically. That's a parameter you have to fix. So add some proportion on to the original image, okay? So here is that proportion, K. Okay, this is just a graphic illustration for the process. Take an image, smooth it. Bring the original image, subtract the smoothed version, get this unsharp mask and add it on top of the original image. This is the sharpened image. And you see, you typically add a K, a parameter here, to add a portion, proportion or weighted version of this unsharp mask G, okay? To get the sharpened image. More examples, this time to show the effect of that K parameter. Again, original image at the top. B is a blurred version of this with a Gaussian filter. This is the unsharp mask, the difference of the two. Result of the unsharp masking with K equals 1 coefficient. And this is, you see, with K equals 4.5. More actually boosted, right? High boost. This is really much boosted. Of course, at some point, it may start to give us some artifacts. So it may not be wise to do this for many or more larger case. So let's see more examples. Here, this is an input image, bone scan. This is another kind of age detector, Laplacian. We will see this actually today. And then we have, let's see, C is adding A and B, okay? I mean, a lot of features are highlighted, but of course also noise is introduced, right? Yeah, I mean, it depends really whether the professional or the expert prefers the original to this one, or this could be just used for analysis in an algorithm. Typically, domain experts like to see their images in the original version, I have to warn you. So be careful before you present them with some processed data. Okay, slight generalization, high boost filtering. Okay, this time you also multiply your original image with a parameter A before, forming the unsharp mask. Because you try to make this difference much larger. So you have A in the original actually difference. When we do this difference without A, this was actually a filter kernel where you had positive in the center, positive weight, and negatives in the other parts. Actually, we will see this soon in the edge detection. A typical edge detector filter, but we are now boosting this center pixel value. Okay, now when you do that again, take the original image, take an edge detection, or do process it with an edge detector. Now with A equals 1 or 1.7, see the different effects that's taking place on this original image. Okay. These pictures are from the book, Digital Image Processing. You can view them. Okay. All right. For instance, this is another kind of filtering which relies on subtraction. This is MR mammography. This example is from probably an old paper from Daniel Rueckert. So this was a image taken before a contrast agent was injected into the body, into blood vessels. Then once that contrast agent goes and actually flows through the body, you take another image. This is, so first one is pre-contrast, the second one is post-contrast. Then you take the difference and you see where this contrast agent was actually could penetrate and where it could not penetrate. When you look at the subtraction signal, in a way, you see suspicious regions where, for instance, there could be a mass here, tumor, for instance, here. These techniques are highly used in medical imaging, by the way. If in the future you want to work in that area, this image processing computer vision is highly needed, required. Okay, so another kind of nonlinear filter, morphological image filters, these are used also a lot. They typically are used to extract some features, some useful representations. For instance, we can try to extract blobs or objects of some certain sizes. And there are actually, it's amazing, two main morphological operations, two basic operations, and everything else is built on top of those. They are dilate and erode. For instance, here, let's say on the left, this is a synthetic image, of course, but this looks like a galaxy, right? A space image. Space imaging people use these a lot, actually. So there are squares of size 1, 3, 5, 7, 9, and 15 pixels on this left image, original image. Now we will see what this is, but we will use an erosion filter. These are filters, morphological filters. They, let's say, square structuring element, so that's the kernel size of the filter, 13 pixels. If I use erode this image or pass it through an erosion filter with a filter kernel of 13 pixels, actually I am losing all other features in this original image other than or except those objects which are larger than 13 pixels. So that will be just these three large squares. You see them, right? Those are 15 pixel squares, actually, these three guys. And you see they are kept, actually preserved. Everything else is erased. So that's why it's erosion. Now you dilate back with the same structuring element. You enlarge, actually, you see on the right now, I obtain back the original object. So this is, you see, a way of eroding or erasing everything else smaller than some given size. You can actually do this iteratively and get all the different sizes, size objects separately and count them, for instance. That's one idea. So this operation, first erode, then dilate, is called opening. We will see. For instance, this opening I just mentioned can be done. Then there is a closing I will mention. That's actual dilation plus erosion. Then that can be used to eliminate salt and pepper noise. So this is the original image A. B is the morphological filter. You see size 3. Now it's going to erase everything less than size 3, right? So erode, if I erode, of course, first. Now erode, erosion result is here. You see, this is a fingerprint actually image. This is all a very important biometric data. So biometric image processing, biometric data processing is a huge field on its own for security, privacy verification, and many, many such applications. So actually in vision and image processing, biometric, particularly fingerprint images were still probably are studied a lot. So if you take fingerprints, scan fingerprints of millions or billions of people. For Turkey, for instance, you would have 80 million and you scan one person more than once. So you have, let's say, a billion fingerprint images. You have to find a way to process them and match them, right? So this is valid for all countries, of course. So this is an eroded image. Of course, you lose also, you should be careful, you may be losing some important features too. So let's say you just lose that in your desired feature or desired object, there were no features that were less than size three. So then you would assume, hey, I can really get back those features by dilating back again in D, which is dilate back, okay? Now in E, you see this is called, guys, from here to here, if you see my mouse, and erode and dilate, this is opening, okay? You erase these little details. Now you dilate first. No, actually you dilated this guy. Otherwise, if I dilated first, I would be exaggerating or I would not be eliminating the noise. So you dilate this image now. You see it's enlarged, features are enlarged. Now you erode back. Dilation is, this operation is called closing. You try to close the gaps, actually, fill in holes in the image, okay? So yeah, next generation filters are learnable, of course. We let the algorithm learn the filters through artificial neural networks, right? Of course, this is not our topic today. I just wanted to make a note here so that you make the connection. Here in this course, actually, we are learning handcrafted filters and we do handcrafted feature engineering. You have to really know this before you work with learning. You go to machine learning, okay, in visual or data processing. Actually, I think we have some time to do look at the details of this morphological operations. The slides say this is the end, but let's continue a little bit. This will be, actually, you will be responsible because I'm talking about it. So these slides say it's extra because we didn't cover it probably last time. So these morphological operators, they are based on set operations. So if I have two objects in the image, typically one of them will be the filter, of course, here. Let's say A will be the filter, B is an object in the image. I can take union of those, I can take intersection, right? Union, intersection, complement operator, and this is complement and intersect, right? This is the difference operation. Remember, I believe all of you remember this. So in morphological image processing was a huge field, actually, maybe 50 years ago, 50, 60 years ago, when people were working with binary forms, silhouettes of objects, because we assumed objects are represented by their silhouettes, for instance, say black and white, and then the coordinates of the pixels form a complete description of the objects in the image. Okay, so we said we assumed objects are represented as silhouettes of black and white. So we started with binary morphology, but the ideas are extendable to grayscale images. Then objects are like sets, right? So then actually you see objects would appear as these sets in an image grid, and there will be filters which also appear as sets in the image grid, okay? I think this is where we can understand most one of the two basic or and fundamental operations in morphology is dilation and erosion. I was telling you, let's say in my image, let's say the feature or object I'm after is a, or the main object is a rectangle, and let's see how this morphological filter B, it's a disk, let's say, centered at the origin. It could be a square element or have it's a digital grid, of course. However, you can represent a circle. It will be, of course, a quantized circle in spatial grid, but it's fine. So you bring this B on top of, it's again like the mechanics of the spatial filtering we've studied. This structuring element is really the filter, actually, filter kernel. But here they are sets, that's why it's called structuring element. So this B is slided over the image, okay? And you see the operation here will be like the union operation. It's shown by plus as the dilation. It has some, this morphological processing has a mathematics on its own through set operations. I will show you the definition in the next slide, or maybe let's see it here. You see, Bx is where this sub X is where X the B filter is located, structuring element, the center point. These are 2D, of course, but I'm just showing by X. It's a vector. So B. This guy is intersected with A. Whenever that intersection is not empty, I get all those X's. So actually, this is really like union, meaning when you see when I'm really sliding this B over the image, let's say this A, let's see how this A object is affected. Whenever this B center is actually is intersecting with A, actually we will take all those X's into the new set. So you see, in the end of this operation, dilation operation, this dashed line will be the new border for this A set. So that dashed line image or the silhouette, new silhouette, is the dilated A here. Okay, this is, I think, exactly the same thing explained. Shift B, set B over A, or assign the intersection of shifted B and A to each center pixel point, actually. Okay. Is it like the remember original convolution, there is a reflection, but when B is symmetric, of course, again remember the correlation convolution ideas, this is the same. Typically and almost always we use a symmetric filter actually for with morphology, so it's really actually B itself here, but normally like the convolution, this is the flipped filter. By the way, guys, in deep learning field, we say convolution, but we typically don't learn the Phillips filters. It's correlation, but we say convolutional CNNs, right? convolutional neural networks. Actually, we've seen the relation. I think I'm hoping this course was useful to you in that respect. You see, what you're doing is actually correlation, but we don't, because they are learnable filters already. We don't care whether they are flipped or not. We could have learned the flipped versions too, but it's the same for us. It doesn't matter. Okay. I mean, the learning takes care of that flipping. That's what I'm trying to say. So now this is the second basic operation, erosion of the object by structuring element B. This time, this is the mathematical explanation. Erosion is typically, yes, represented by either, I think, no, not an open circle. An open circle will be opening, I will tell. It's a minus. Dilation was a plus in a circle. This is a minus in a circle. So all x's touch that this B, x stays in A. So this is really like an intersection, because we're talking about the center point. Whenever I slide this B, this circle, over my grid, image grid, whenever it stays inside the object A, remember this A is all ones, everything else is zeros. So this would tell me the dashed line here would be the resulting filtered object, actually. Yeah, so you see A is eroded from this solid line to this dashed line, but actually it will be also smoothed. We can't get a corner like that. So you see dilation erosion, we've just learned dilation in general causes objects to dilate or grow in size. Erosion causes objects to shrink. They are duals of each other, of course, with respect to set complementation and reflection. So you can really take complement of the erosion operator. That's why mathematically they were defined in those somewhat strange ways, not just intersection or union, which is also actually, which probably you can see as somewhat they are duals of each other, but this is more proper. Now you say you have A complement dilated with the reflected B hat. Is the result of this complementation, but you are not responsible from the algebra of the morphology. This is a whole new or extended field, okay? Because it's sliding over the objects, the image grid, and it's doing a union, and it's a max actually operation when you have binary objects, okay? So we, in a way, we include all the dilated or grown parts of the object. We include it in the object, okay? And now it says amount and way they grow or shrink depend upon choice of the structuring element. So some standard structuring elements like this plus sign or square, right? This is 4 neighborhood, 8 neighborhood, of course. Ideally it's a circular disk. It should be a symmetric disk like thing. If it's a larger element, we can try to approximate a circle. Of course, these are not restricted. Morphology is not restricted to 2D plane. It could be defined in 1D, 2D, 3D or higher. The other types of structuring elements, for instance, it could be a 1D structuring element like this. It could be a diamond like this, right? Then these are in the rectangular grid. They correspond to the first row corresponds to this, those filters in the second row, okay? So some examples, for instance, this is the original image, top left, A. Image is eroded using a square structuring element of size. This is by 11 by 11. Erosion. So you see all those features here less than diameter is less than 11 is erased, right? Erosion is erasing. So these lines were erased, only this line remains, but now it's not the original size. Normally we need a dilation afterwards because we shrink the features in the image. But let's say I used a 15 by 15 filter. Now this is obviously, it was less than 15 in diameter, so they are also deleted. You see all these connecting lines are deleted, but the other features in the image whose diameter originally were much, much thicker, you see they stayed. Here, a very extreme example, you eroded by a filter of 45 by 45 size. Now, other than the center object, the thickest blob here, all other features are deleted, okay? You see what's happening, right? This is like set operations because this is zero and one. These are ones and background is zero. And the structuring element itself is a set, similarly all ones on its own, on it. And of course it's zero outside. So it's sliding over this image and with, carrying out this erosion operation. Now let's look at dilation. For instance, this is a image which shows some text, which have some gaps in it. So you may be like, hey, let me process this with a dilation because it has broken characters. I take this structuring element, you see, this four neighborhood set, dilation of A by this, of this image by this filter, you see, brings me the thickened characters now. And you look at the blow up here, the zoom. EA characters, they are thickened. But of course, there is a danger here. You may be filling in holes, and if I filled in this E top segment, I may lose the feature of E. So there is a trade-off, of course. But still, it's important, good to know erosion and dilation. You can use them in different ways, consecutively, in parallel. You can give effects like thickening, thinning. You can even do skeletonization. We combine them to get new operations. For instance, opening, erosion followed by dilation. If I had a triangle structure, an object in the image, and I open it with this B structuring element, it gives me this solid line or the solid set. Here it's the contours, here it's the set actually. You see the smoothing effect at the corners, right? Opening means actually I first eroded, you see, I would shrink and then dilate by the same structuring element. Actually we are losing, the goal here is to get rid of the sharp corners. Closing. Now this is dilation followed by erosion. This would try to close actually. Close these ridges, sharp corners this time from outside in a way. So it's like B is rolling outside and smoothing our borders. So now I would first dilate and then shrink. I'm closing some of these things. Actually, let me see, I should find a better. Huh, this is a probably better example, especially for the opening. For instance, for opening with an appropriate structuring element, if this was the original structure in the image, opening will lose this protrusion, thin protrusion, okay? Closing, smooth, okay, sections of contour. So let's see, dark dashed line is the opening result. Okay, here we have the opening result. We don't have the closing result, okay? But closing tends to eliminate small holes and fill gaps in contours. Huh, here is a closing example. This time, actually, this was a similar original object. You see, this was the original object feature here. This time in inner protrusion. This will be closed now with this dashed, look at the solid dashed line, that would be the result of your opening. So smoothing from the outside, holes are filled in, okay? Narrow valleys are closed. I mean, there are some more examples similar. You can use a very interesting non-symmetric structuring element like this, for instance, and you would see its effect at the corners here. And again, you are really rounding from the inside and getting rid of these sharp corners. Let's see. I think we've seen this already. You see now this circle, which is not filled. It's a morphological opening operation symbol. And when it's a circle with filled, dark, you see this circle here, solid circle, I should say. Then that represents the closing operator. And if you do them, you see you can concatenate all these different filter effects and get different results, of course. We've seen this already. Important things to note, morphological operations try to preserve main geometric structures, but you may be actually trying to do other things like counting the number of objects, then you don't want to preserve it actually. The important thing is only features smaller than the structuring element are affected by the transformations. This is, I think, very nice. So morphological filters are a very important class of nonlinear filters, you should know, okay? And all other features at larger scales are not degraded. And these are, by the way, these observations are not valid with linear transforms, such as given by convolution, okay? This is erosion, A erode. So B is the structuring elements shown here. So you erode A by B, then you take a set difference actually. So let's see what is happening. You erode, this is an erosion. You see here, assume this dark are the objects, dark pixels, dark intensities, show me the silhouette of the object. This is after erosion, actually. The shrinking, you can see shrinking of the object. Now take the difference between these two, set difference. You see it leaves me with the boundaries of a set, of the set. So this is like a boundary extractor. You see this operation now. Now, yes, apply that, for instance, to this silhouette of a person and you get these boundary pixels. Okay, so you see you started to extract features. Similarly, apply it on the image on the left and obtain these boundaries of these grains, for instance. I'm not sure whether this is a synthetic image or a real, looks like a processed real image actually. So of grains, and you may want to later maybe actually count these, segment these, or look at the boundaries. So for instance, here, filling, region filling, of course it's closing actually. This is, for instance, you want to fill in these circles, white circles, you may, then you have to choose the appropriate sized structuring element and obtain this on the right. Let me see. Okay, filling, this is just showing filling operation on one example, but this is just applying it on all images, all pixel points, sorry. The question is for RGB, a good point, because already this is a structural filter, right? It doesn't care about the color. So like you said, we may, one wise idea may be, for instance, use hue saturation value or just the luminance component and use the morphological filter on that, or you can use it on RGB separately. But my guess is you better, it's better to use it. I mean, my suggestion is to better to use the luminance or the gray image. There are gray versions of these morphological filters, or you can binarize, of course, the image. Of course, then the application area will be limited. The gray value operation extension is actually now the set operation intersection, for instance, becomes a min filter. The union becomes a max filter. You can then apply all these operations similarly, somewhat, most of them, but whichever is applicable. Of course, for counting things, for instance, filling holes, counting things, yes, this is really much more suitable to binarized images, right? Like I said, this is after morphology, form, shape, silhouette. That's why especially dedicated to binary or grayscale images, okay? Yes, for instance, I said gray value morphology, replace binary sets with gray value images, replace AND operation with min or operation with max. Okay. Yeah, when I was saying intersection, that's an AND operation, and union, it's an OR operation, OR like operation. Of course, with grayscale images, you may not always get what you want. It's a little bit tricky, grayscale morphology. So that's why I think it's better to really work with, once you have, for instance, segmentation, we will see, you may then do use your morphological operations. We will do it in actual segmentation topic, because you may get effects here that you don't want, as you see here in this example at the bottom. Okay. For instance, people used it for texture segmentation. You see on the image, on the left here in the image, on the left hand side, you have smaller circles, a smaller texture pattern, a small circle texture pattern. On the right, a larger circle texture pattern. You may want to find the boundaries in between. Normally, finding such a boundary may not be that easy by straightforward or standard segmentation technique. So you may use morphology. You may, for example, close the image by successively using larger structuring elements. So get rid of this site. Exactly done here. You see, close the image. These guys are closed. Okay. Okay, here the actually the objects are dark, background is light. So you have to be careful this time. Actually, you may have to, let me see, do closing and opening, or closing first. Okay, yes, you want to close first. So close these guys. If it was other way around, it was light circles by dark background, you may want to open first, okay? Now it's vice versa. First close, get rid of the small circles. Now, let's see. In C, what do I do? Open image with light patches between large blobs removed by opening. Huh, here this time you actually connect, open these, you connect these guys to each other. So dilate, I would dilate this white part. Remember, dilation works on the plus ones, ones. So dilate it, these guys, these whites will be in a way diffusing, right? Dilate and erode. Now let's let me see. Dilate whites, but that's an opening here, right? That's why it's an opening. Open, so it's erode first, dilate next, you get then the right hand side as it is. Now get the border, it's very easy, where the contrast changes, you see the border here, overlay it on the original image, you get to segment the image into two different textural regions. Segmentation we will study, but here we see a glimpse of it. Okay. Now open image, let's see. Yes, C was opening with a separation, a structuring element whose separation distance was, or whose size was larger than the separation distance between these blobs in order to be able to close them. That's the idea. So imagine you are placing white circles on top of these. Those are your structuring elements, okay? Is that clear? I think this must be the last one. All right, let's continue with our next topic, which is also very important. It's edge detection. And it's actually it's very similar to what we've been doing, because we will be using filtering again. But they will be specific filters to detecting edges. Okay, so this is our week six, by the way, and let's look at our learning outcomes. Students will be able to, you guys will be, our objective is, will be able to design and implement still neighborhood operation-based spatial filters, these space domain filters, okay? And actually, this also ties to feature extraction. So in a way, you are coming up with techniques to extract relevant information from images. So I want to motivate it first, because actually since last week, we were trying to smooth images, filter to extract some features, enhance images, unsharpen or sharpen images. But now there is a specific purpose in our processing edges, because they are really, these edges are, by the way, what are they? They are very important in our visual understanding, visual processing in the brain. Maybe let's motivate by this experiment. Alfred Yarbus was a Soviet scientist actually working in this field. And he was actually in like 50s or 60s working on creating these eye movement maps. So for instance, look at this image on the left, the a portrait of a girl, and then tracking the eye movements, you can plot, and this is from the studies of this scientist, plots the actual where our gaze is wandering around, trajectories of our gaze. You see, actually, this is currently, by the way, we can do this by an eye tracking device in our age currently, right? You probably have seen these. You put this device on and it really follows your pupils, eye pupils and your gaze, you know, where you are looking in the scene. And this it helps us to understand how our visual system uses and inspects scenes and objects, and how it perceives the surroundings or the visual scene it is presented. And can you tell me, looking at this experiment from maybe 60, 70 years ago, what this scientist could have concluded? Especially look at these contours. Let me give a hint to you, contour-like trajectory here. What is the and this is, let's say, a typical trajectory. As a scientist, of course, you don't do this with one person. You do this with at least 50 person or 30, 50, 100 persons. Of course, the more the better to really validate your hypothesis. But you come up with a hypothesis once you look at a few trajectories like this. And what is that in the perception, understanding of the surroundings or of a visual scene, our visual system uses or looks at, especially pays attention to what kind of regions, especially look at the contours. Exactly, more like edges, meaning the places where actually there is a transition, right? A contrast change, actually high contrast change between two regions. So it's a transition from one region to region. Especially look at the face contours and also contours of other objects like nose, mouth, eyes. Here is another nice example, which says, of course, in our visual perception, context is important. So for instance, this is again from, you see, 1967 from the same scientist. Shows this picture to a people or and then records this trajectory of the eye movements. This is a free examining of this scene, okay? This is a scene, you see it's in a dining or living room, a person enters the room, this woman stands up. You see, you are really exploring most of the scene, but let's say you are looking for the economic conditions of the family, you may be this time more wandering around the objects, right? The sofa, table, maybe the paintings on the wall, things like that. What are the ages of the persons? How old are these people? Then you see, look at the trajectories, they concentrate on the faces of the people. If you want to remember the clothes, you look differently, or you scan the picture differently. What were they doing before the arrival? Okay, maybe this should be around the room. Like, for instance, how long has the unexpected visitor been away? Again, you would be probably wandering around the people's faces, etc. So, I mean, the point here is, I hope it's clear. Of course, for visual perception, context is important. But one of the existing or always existing cues is the edges, the transitions between objects or contours of objects. And you can see it also here in these, especially in this one, of course, trajectories of eye movements. So I ask this every year again until this week our filtering operations, we were, remember, for those operations we were coming up with a filter kernel, and our goal, main goal, was denoising, smoothing and averaging, and the mathematical operator was in a way integration, which is summing, right? Because averaging or smoothing is an integration operation. Now for age detection, we are saying we look at transitions, right? Which of mathematical operator this time we should be looking at? Because integration operation, this sum average idea gave us actually the pattern or expected filter kernels, how they should be. Now, what kind of mathematical operator our age detection will be based on? I think probably you've already said, yes, derivation. It will be derivative operation, opposite of integration, because we are after now abrupt changes in image intensity. And changes, when we talk about abrupt changes, that's talking about image derivatives. So now we define an edge first, and then we go to the specific type of edge filters. Observation, boundaries of objects show up as intensity discontinuities. This is a synthetic example, very simple image. One side is black, one side is white. Now look at the 1D profile of, so 1D profile meaning take one row from this image and plot the intensities. It's this step edge, right? You can have, of course, more graded, more smooth edges. In this case, still you have a transition from a black intensity to white intensity or dark to light. And depending on what we call the gradient of this edge here, we will have the steepness that will determine the steepness of this edge, okay? So exactly, edges signify for us in an image object boundaries. That's why they are important. And we will look at these abrupt changes in the images. So edge is actually, it will be calculated from image in a neighborhood of the pixel. It can, we can say, we can come up with a, when extracting edges from images, what does it mean? We can come up with an edge map like this, okay? Or, but normally edge also has a direction. So normally actually we can come up with a vector variable like the gradient, actual magnitude of the gradient and gradient direction, okay? So we may also include both the magnitude of the edges, like how sharp this discontinuity is. You see here is a sharp discontinuity and I can see it at the sleeve of this girl, the t-shirt. But then also there are edge normals I have to plot. We will come to this soon. So let's look at some edge models. Left to right, this is a step edge, right? Ideal case. But we rarely or we never have this in our images because we typically have smoother transitions. I mean, in physical scenes that we are imaging, due to many of these, of course, imaging processes like quantization, spatial sampling and things like that, all those light intensities, and even in physical world, actually, they are continuous. So these abrupt changes are rare, but they may happen, by the way. Ideally, also, our life would be much easier if we had this case all the time. Practice, in practice, we see ramp edges. So our images have more blurred edges like this. You see from, again, darker to lighter, there is a transition. So 1D profile would have a slope, not this infinite slope like this. And we may have a roof or a line-like edge. This is a model of a line. So look at the profile. Of course, these could be in other way around. It could go from light to dark and then to light again. Okay, these are intensity profiles. Of course, if I ask you this, I think you would easily now respond. For instance, A is this ramp edge in 3, B is this roof-like edge or line-like edge in 4, C is the step edge in I, and this is a constant, again, ideal constant image, so the profile signal is constant. More example, I mean, the more examples of the same phenomenon showing different types of edges in a real image this time. This is a CT image. And from here also you can find pixels or in local neighborhoods where you see this different three different types of edges. So if, yeah, by the way, of course, if there may be uniform regions, if the gray value is uniformly varying, then there is not an edge, like the background here, it's all constant. But for instance, here, from the sinuses to this tissue here, around the nose, then you see this, in a way, step-like edge. Here at this pixel point, there is more a ramp-like edge, and here you see line. I was saying this is a line edge, right? So you see this protrusion to outside. This is showing us this roof or line edge. Okay. So we will use for edge detection gradient, and also in the discrete world, these are difference-based operators, and they will help us detect and measure local discontinuities in intensity. Okay. So again, for instance, this is an image of a dark circle, a real image actually, and you take a profile between these two x signs here, meaning in plot the intensities, you get this guy. Again, for edge detection, our goal is to be able to give in our edge map some large values in these discontinuities, okay? So let's look at, after the edge types actually, let's look at some operators, but let me see. Here we're trying to say we want to measure the rate of change in image brightness, okay? We've already seen these models, so we will be looking at the slope of the ramp in a way, right? So first derivative, okay, yeah. So we will look at first derivative. Here it's trying to say this is an image here. You see this is where the edge region is. Let's look at the intensity profile in this neighborhood. It is marked here. The 1D profile shows us a ramp edge here, okay, dark, and increases to lighter values, ideal, a very nice ramp edge. Now take the derivative of this. Of course, we will do this in 2D, but let's just study in 1D. This is the first derivative, right? Here we have a constant, I mean, it's an ideal ramp edge, so a constant derivative here. Now take the second derivative. I mean, our goal was what kind of operators we can use. First derivative, yes, we see it helps us. It can help us to detect the edges, right? We will be like, hey, this first derivative will be small when there is no edge, and it will give us a response, non-zero response when there is an edge. So we can use it. But let's check if we can use the second derivative. Now take the derivative of the first derivative. You see here is a increasing or positive edge, right? So it's a positive derivative here. And then here at this side, it's actually a decreasing edge. So now I have a negative gradient here. So negative derivative. So you see actually in the second derivative, we can see around an edge, there is a positive negative, or it could be the vice versa, negative positive, right? So we check zero crossing actually. There is a crossing from negative to positive or positive to negative. Then second derivatives can be used in that way, okay? Because they give us this double response for an edge. And the same idea will carry from 1D profiles to 2D, of course. Okay? I think this is very similar to, just to repeat, if I had first derivatives like this and second derivatives you see in this way, this double response, what is my object? If this would be the original profile, actually, an object meaning this is, these are the boundaries. There are two edges here, okay? And you see with first derivative, I'm detecting the two. This is more like somewhat a profile from a real line. This was an ideal, ideal profile, okay? So now, and also this is different, right? This is like what we've studied here. So that was exactly like an object. And if I had black here, black part of the image, that would be similar to exactly this object. And I see the double-sided derivatives here in second derivative, and the same here. You see, this time I have a negative gradient from larger values to smaller, and my second derivative goes from negative to positive exactly. So now, how to implement? I hope you understand the idea. We will implement it again with convolution masks, typically many. And then we have to create discrete approximations to these differential operators. Again, let's say if it was a 3x3 edge mask, filter mask, right? We have to find values for this omega 1 to omega 9. Of course, we will take a look at the calculus. We fill in this through looking at our numerical methods background. We look at the difference operators, because in continuous world they are differential operators, but we want to discretize them. So let's see how to write the derivative. I can expand my function. This is valid in 2D2 around some nominal value x0, let's say, in this way, right? This is a first order expansion with O of H approximation. Then just evaluate at a perturbation of this center pixel value, actual pixel coordinate, x0 plus h. So actually, this is also a Taylor series expansion, right? F of x0 plus h is f of x0 plus this h, the perturbation times the derivative, first derivative plus O of h. Now from here, I can isolate the derivative, f prime, first derivative. You see, I get, remember, from your numerical methods, the forward difference operator. So this is a approximator to the derivative, first order derivative. And I can write this as a backward difference. Look at, you can do the math here, but first order backward difference, my first order derivative of this function with respect to x is f of x minus f of x minus h over h. I can also get a second center difference equation. Remember, this is very simple and you already studied this in numerical methods. Remember, this is then my derivative can be approximated by addition of the two neighbors, x plus h, x minus h, sorry, the difference between the two neighbors over 2h. Okay, this is its derivation. Now, here we added, let me see, we subtracted these. Now let's go to the O of H square approximation in our Taylor series expansion. Also includes the second derivative. Now let's see, when we take the difference, I think, yes, we cancel these, right? That's how we got F prime. Now, second order approximations, let me see. I'm trying to look at second center difference equation. Guys, you can go over these. These are very simple. I assume everybody is familiar with this Taylor series expansion. I do a perturbation plus h, a perturbation minus h. I add them up. This is the derivation of the second derivative, this finite difference equation, by the way. This time, not subtract them, but add them up, because I'm trying to keep the second derivative. Now the first derivative cancels, remember. Now my second order derivative, it's a second centered difference, is add the two neighbors, x plus h, x minus h, and subtract two times the center. Now pay attention, in the denominator I have h squared, okay? This is now assuming, now from now on, I assume you know how to discretize these derivatives and calculate these finite difference derivatives in any signal or image or data you are given. So let's say I have an image like this. You see there is a white dot here. That's an isolated point. That's like an artifact you are trying to, let's say, get rid of. That's noise, some kind of noise. Of course, it could be a feature, but let's say this time you are Actually, here I'm not trying to denoise it. I'm trying to just analyze what happens in the profile and what happens in the derivatives. So take a 1D image intensity profile, and this is my intensity profile at that line, at that row. You see, I have a ramp edge here. I have this roof-like or isolated point edge, a flat segment, another a line edge here, actually. This was a point, but line-like segment here, and then there is a step edge at this location or this region. First derivative, what is the first derivative at this point? So at this isolated point location, of course, you have to first define whether it's a centered difference equation or forward or backward. If it's a centered difference, right, I have to, let me see here, which one they calculated, let me see. I'm trying to see. Here we calculated forward difference. Okay, forward derivative. Let's do it that way. 0 and minus 6 over 1, right? Typically for pixel perturbation h, it's the coordinate perturbation, it's 1, h equals 1. So I have a minus 6 derivative here. 6 derivative, the derivative equals to 6 is actually obtained over this 0 here, where the edge is starting. You can calculate or fill in all these derivatives. Please do so, okay? Calculate all these derivatives with forward difference, backward difference, center difference. Do the same for second derivative. So add the 2, 0, and subtract twice the center point, minus 12. You see, and 8 squared is 1, so I have minus 12. So you see, I have 0 crossings here at the second derivative. 6 to minus 12, minus 12 to 6. So I can see, you can use second derivative as a 0 crossing detector and an edge detector. And for the first derivative, I can actually use its magnitude because it's large. I know there is an edge there, okay? You can do the same math for all. This is actually, this was expanded, this profile here. This is the profile if you plot it in scale, actually, the correct scale. You see going over here. This is, I hope everybody can visualize what this profile corresponds to if you take a line or row of intensity values from this row, which corresponds to this white dot, bright dot. One, I hope at this point, by this point, you are clear with the idea of discretized derivative computations. I'm hoping everybody is clear with that. Now, before we move on to the filter kernels, just mention one more thing. Let's say this is my original signal, and let's say I have noise. In my recording of this signal, the signal contains noise. Now, calculating the derivative on top of this or on the noisy image makes a huge difference. Look at the derivatives. Although this is a smooth signal, I would normally expect smooth derivatives. Calculating the derivatives on a noisy signal gives me much, much noisier derivatives. So derivative amplifies noise, actually. That's the idea. So let's see, here is an example, nice example. Let's say this was the original image. They are on purpose synthetically created images with different levels of noise. So, and also gradings, right? On purpose, you see here gradings of, or different kinds of edges, like a step edge, ramp edge, and things like that. Okay, so let's see here. On the left, I have, okay, the image, and then in the center, I have the first derivative. Okay, on the right, I have the second derivative. So also, I'm showing it on images, and the noise levels are increasing as we go down here. Gaussian noise of standard deviation 0.1, 1, and 10, you see. Now, look at the first derivative, the profile. As this is the ramp edge, the derivative, and this double response, the second derivative, positive, negative, I see, which is correct. Now, I mean, which is nice, nicely visible. Now added with image with addition of some small amount of noise. Look at the derivatives. Okay, the profile is still nice. First derivative starts to show some of the edges. Second derivative is even noisier because you amplify, continue amplifying noise. You take a second time derivative, right? You can still make out here. You can see the double edge, the zero crossing, or I mean the positive negative edge in the second derivative, but noise is getting there. Now with more noise, look at the first derivative, that's also corrupted, but second derivative is really, really noisy, and it even much more noise. Both the first derivative and second derivative, there is almost no way to extract edge information, right, from these derivatives. Therefore, the lesson from this slide is image smoothing before computing derivatives is always required. Okay, if you are going to do any edge-like operation, you need to do image smoothing, okay? Pre-processing, I mean. Before we move on to filter kernels, we should talk about image gradient, because now our image in 2D, we were talking about 1D derivatives, but in 2D now it's a gradient, right? Because this is a multivariable function, I or F, whatever name you give it, I of xy. Now when you take its first partial derivatives, you need partial derivatives with respect to x. That's the first argument of the gradient vector. Partial derivative of I with respect to y, that's the second argument of the gradient vector. Now you plot this vector on top of this image, you get your gradient vector field. Vector field is a gradient is a vector field because it means that in your special grid at each point you don't have a scalar value but a vector with some direction, and you can plot that to see here, for instance, from the blobs, because background is dark, blobs are lighter, we see these outgoing gradient vectors, right? These are, we call normals of the contours actually, they are pointing in the normal direction. So this is, you see, giving us a lot of information, and its magnitude also helps us to get these edges. So in basic edge detection, one idea is we compute the image gradient vector, and now you know how to calculate del I by del x, del I by del I, y. This is the first derivative in the horizontal direction, exactly as here. This is the center difference, ix plus y minus ix minus 1y. Okay, over 2. And then the other one is the difference in the y direction, y plus 1, y minus 1 intensity differences. Now you have a vector. Let's say if it was here, now the gradient direction, it always points in the normal of the edge actually. Okay? And you can find the edge direction by the angle of this vector. Okay? So the direction you can calculate, right, of a 2D vector. It's from the arctangent del I del y over del I del x. Now, let's look at the filter kernels. A general 3x3 spatial filter max. Recall, until now, response of the mask was R, and it was more like actually smoothing or averaging before, and we were trying to actually, in smoothing, trying to do some integration operation. So these filter weights sum to typically 1 or some positive value, as you recall. But for edge detection, some of the kernel weights will be 0, desired. That's preferred because we want in uniform or homogeneous regions, we want the kernel, edge kernel to return 0 to us. It shouldn't give response in not changing regions. But with the smoothing or averaging mask or filters, we wanted to give us a constant result. That's why they sum to 1, right? This is the main difference. You should be careful. For instance, this is a filter a mask which is actually designed as to give more weight to this more center pixel, and it takes a difference, you see, between it's like actually 2 minus 2, right? 1 minus 1, 1 minus 1. But actually, ideally, maybe I should, when you look at the derivatives here, maybe first let me tell you this. You can come up with a mask actually. You would have a 1 in the x plus 1, minus 1 in the x minus 1, right? And the same with these two guys, and zeros in between. So normally I would have actually a mask where this is 1, this is minus 1 in the horizontal detector. And then for the vertical detector, I would have the other way around. And again, note that the sum of the weights sum to zero. Zero. Of course, for smoothing, it's vice versa. I mean, it's a positive number. So this is an example filter mask for a horizontal edge detector. I hope intuitively you are fine. So let me show you some different filter masks and ask you which one here are for edge detection you think would be, and which one would be for smoothing. W3 is for edge detection. Actually, the other guys can also help us. For instance, the first one we will see is a diagonal edge detector. You're right. The fourth one is definitely a smoother, right? W4. We will see all these examples actually. So let's see. This is showing, this slide could have come earlier, showing the gradient vector at each pixel with its direction vector displayed. And magnitude, so here before we go to the kernel, it's trying to say we can calculate the gradient vector and we can look at its magnitude to judge the strength of the edge, and also look at its direction to actually give us an feature, actually a local feature, the directionality of edge in that neighborhood. With these filters, we can also design filters oriented towards different directions to be able to give us the features in different orientations. But let's start with simple operators or filters. For instance, this was the earliest or one of the most easy simple masks, edge masks. And you see it, the person, they took the names of the person, people, scientists who or engineers who designed them. Here, this person, Roberts operator, came up with 1 minus 1 on the two diagonal here, and again 1 minus 1 in the on the other two. Again, you see it satisfies this sum to zero condition. If you filter the image by these two by two masks, it looks at diagonal differences. It's not a preferred mask, by the way, but still it's the earliest, one of the earliest. And then you try to combine the two responses together to give you an edge mask. That's the idea. So you see this guy is doing this in a way, actually the first spatial masking operation, the first term here in the parentheses, and the second parenthesis gives me the second operation here. You can square them and take the square root to get its L2 norm of these two responses, or you can take their absolute value and sum them to get the edge response. Okay? They are not symmetric around center point. They don't have an edge direction information. And it's a very, very local mask, right? Two by two, they will become more sensitive to noise. Then people also came up with 3x3 masks. You see two separate masks, one for horizontal edges. You see this is for horizontal edges, this is for vertical edges. Then you calculate the responses. So pass WY and WX through your image, mask your image, or convolve in a way your image with these masks. Get RX, you see RX or RY. I mean, I just wrote RX here. It's this masking operation, okay? Here, it's the convolution operation also. Let me see. I mean, these are not symmetric, but still you have the vice versa, right? Even if you flip them, should be fine. And the shifts are not written here, but it's actually implicit. K, sub K gives us the shifts. So this is really like convolution or correlation. Then look at the magnitude of this response, Rx, the response to the first filter and response to the second filter. Then take their L2 norm, and that gives me the edge magnitude. This can be used as the image gradient magnitude, and the direction is given by arc tangent Ry over Rx, okay? Another filter, this is by Erwin Sobel, one of the earlier image processing people, scientists. I actually worked with him during an internship in the past. Very nice guy. He was at he worked for many, many years at HP Labs, Palo Alto. I was an intern there, and he was one of the people I was working with. Very nice guy. He, I think in 60 or 70s, he was one of the first people to suggest these masks. The this is very similar to the Previt, but now, like I said, gives a little bit more emphasis to the center pixels, and diagonals stay as 1 and minus 1. The centers are minus 2 and 2. Now, again, calculate your mask response to these two filters, find the magnitude and edge direction, okay? You can then come up with more variations. These are Kirsch compass masks, 8 major orientations, north, northwest, west, southwest, south, southeast, east, and northeast. Again, now the edge magnitude, maximum value found by the convolution of each mask with the image, and edge direction again is defined by the mask that produces the maximum magnitude. These are the masks. You can see that, for instance, north is, you see here, minuses here at the top, pluses at the bottom. So that's a edge that's giving me an this north signifies the direction of the gradient. Actually, you just imagine that vector. So that would point in the north. West is this time, you see, in this direction. Southeast are similar. Let's look at northwest. You see now minus threes are on this side. You can imagine a diagonal edge in this way, right? And with a, actually a gradient like this way. Southwest and southeast, northeast are similar. For instance, if northwest direction response produces, or this edge mask, northwest mask produces the maximum value, then you conclude the edge direction is northwest. These are similarly, somebody else came up with this time different mask coefficients. This is the Sobel, like uses the Sobel like coefficients, right? And but the directions are similar. But this time it keeps zeros all in the diagonals. You see here it was minus three, minus three. It was giving more weight to the diagonals too. Here it's not giving weight to the diagonals. They are all zeros. In order to detect this edge, which mask you guys should use or could use? You ask, you answer that, and then we can end today's lecture. Next time we can finish up the edge detection. Then we have actually a lot of material here, like Laplacian masks and more advanced edge filters, actually. Second order, second derivative masks, zero crossing masks, and we have Kenny edge detection.